Okay, so I'm back and I'm gonna talk a little bit about some personality types. And again, these are just, you know, I had my own terms for them long before I read George Leonard's book. I mean, we used to have people that would come into school and they would be, I would consider them dilettantes. And a dilettante is someone who doesn't take things all that seriously. They're just kind of whimsical and they have a very playful personality, which is very nice, but they don't really take things that seriously. They just dabble around and fool around. So he calls them the dabbler, I call them a dilettante. There's also the obsessive, which he talks about. And we're gonna talk about each one of these a little more in depth. I'm just kind of going over them briefly. So the obsessive is you know, type A, go, 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 win at all costs type personality, right? And then we have the hacker, which kind of, it's like it sounds, they just kind of hack around and they kind of half-ass things and they don't really take things all that seriously and they're never really that hot on staying in training and learning new things. They're just kind of, they make it to a pretty high level, but they're not masters. They're kind of hackers. And we're not really even talking about the master personality because that one's taken for granted that we've already been talking, we're gonna be talking about that the whole time. So these are personalities that really aren't conducive to mastery. Okay, so if you fall into one of these categories, like I said, one thing that is hopeful is that at the end he talks about, in closing, people can be hybrids of these archetypes. For example, someone can be a dabbler in love and a master in his or her art. However, the basic patterns tend to prevail, both reflecting and shaping your performance, your character, and your destiny. So hardwired into us are certain personality types. Some are from instilled from parents, teachers, a myriad of different things that we get exposed to throughout our lives. At some point, we need to take responsibility for who we are and how we're constructed and either make an incredible effort to change it or we need to just accept it and as to what it is and not expect. The pain and suffering comes when we expect to be something that we're not. Like when a dabbler comes into our school and wants to be working at Pixar, there's a delusion of grandeur that's occurring. My job as a teacher is to reel that in and be pragmatic and realistic, not idealistic. That can be a hard thing to do, right? As a teacher, that can be, you can fall on deaf ears. It can create a lot of tension between the student and the teacher. It can create a lot of angst. So I've found it very challenging in my own personal experience with teaching is how to get people to see realistically the personality type which they don't see that they are. So they see themselves as something they aren't. And so they're projecting outwards. They're not tuned in to their true gifts or their true personality type. Okay, so let's start with the dabbler. Now the dabbler, I wrote some quick notes because he goes over it in 5-6 pages each or something, and I just kind of broke it down into some quick tips that I thought were, you know. So this person loves new jobs, they love new offices, and they love new colleagues. They delight in signs of progress. So they're always looking for progress, they like their environment, they're really excited when they come into work. So, but when the plateau comes, this person's enthusiasm quickly wanes. They start rationalizing why they're not getting better. They look for a way out and they move on to the next job, the next sport, the next relationship. So the dabbler often thinks of himself or herself as an adventurer, a connoisseur of novelty. But in reality, it's closer to what Carl Jung, the famous psychologist, calls the eternal kid. So they're like an eternal 5-year-old. They're just, oh, this is great. Oh, wonderful. Oh, this is hard. I'm on to the next thing. Oh, this is wonderful. This is fun. Oh, no, that's too hard. Oh, this is wonderful. This is fun. And they're just running through life from thing to thing to thing, always looking for the quick fix, always looking for the fun. Oh, everything's so fun and great. But when it gets hard, nowhere to be seen. Gone. You know, what happened to so-and-so? I thought they were in the class. No, gone. Dropped out. So I see it all the time. Now, in relationships, because he talks about how this works in relationships, they specialize in honeymoons, right? When the initial ardor starts to cool, they start looking around for someone new. So to stay on the path of mastery would mean challenging oneself. How much easier to jump in another bed and start the process all over. And so they don't stick it out in relationships a lot of times. They just jump to the next person that looks entertaining until they're bored with that and it gets difficult and then they jump to the next one. So again, this is a person that doesn't stick with things. So if you're a dabbler or you find yourself kind of dabbling, So it's not going to be conducive to getting good at art or anything else for that matter. So that's just a certain personality type. And I've seen them many times. A lot of times these people don't think that they're dabblers. That's the problem. They think that they are masters and they think they are in the master's course or trajectory. And they're so far off of it that it's hard to even rationalize with them sometimes. Sometimes they're so far delusionary or out of left field that you really can't even get to them. So the challenge as a good teacher is how do you take someone like that, reel them in, instill in them patience, perseverance, persistence, practice, and get them to not be a dabbler. That is freaking hard work, is what that is. And that's why you'll see very few teachers that are willing to put forth that energy to reprogram. That's just one person. You might have 52 of those people in your class, in your school, that need that kind of coercion, and also aren't seeing clearly that that's who they are, a dabbler. So that just a little note out there for teachers that are listening to this. So the obsessive is which is the next person we're going to talk about, is a bottom line type of person, a type A, like I said. So their results are what count. That's all that counts. There's no points for second place. It's first or nothing. And they start out making robust progress because they're intense. And I see these people come into our school all the time, and they're just driven, and I'm going to be good. And they're burning 17 classes a week, and they're going hard, and they're making all this progress because it's new and it's the beginning, and you make tons of progress the first year or so you're at our atelier or in the process. And then it slows down. So when it slows down, this person can't handle that. So they redouble their efforts and they train even harder, right? So when they hit the plateau, they simply can and won't accept it. They just, I can't accept that I'm flatlining, and I will double my efforts. Well, then what happens is they redouble their efforts in a merciless manner to push through. They look for shortcuts. They start looking for ways around because this is way too hard and this can't be this hard. I'm great at everything and I'm the best and I'm always been the best and I'm an overachiever and all this stuff. So they start looking for those ways around. So although this kind of person looks like they're going to excel and make it the distance, they really are no closer than the dabbler, because they're going to burn themselves right into the tarmac or something of that sort. So corporate America is the realm of the obsessive. The hedge fund managers, the driven drive of Wall Street, the drive of the companies to get higher numbers, to money for their shareholders. This is all that obsessive, don't look at the environment, burn, pillage, just push forward, and in the name of growth and bottom line. Okay, so that's corporate America is really the realm of the obsessive. So in relationships, when the ardor cools, he doesn't look elsewhere. He redoubles his efforts and springs for extravagant gifts, erotic escalations, fancy vacations, anything to keep the momentum going. So the relationship becomes a roller coaster of stormy separations and passionate reconciliations. And although the obsessive does appear to make some forward progress, he also experiences sharp declines, a jagged ride towards a sure fall, is what that personality represents to George Leonard. That was in his words. So the next one is the hacker. Okay, so we've talked about the dabbler, not gonna make it. We've talked about the obsessive, not gonna make it. Now we're gonna talk about the hacker. So the hacker is willing to stay on the plateau indefinitely. So they've got that going for themselves. But he or she does not mind skipping stages essential to the development of mastery. In other words, they'll stay on the plateau, but they don't stay in the trajectory of consistent get this, then get this, then get this, and build significantly on a good foundation. So they jump around a lot. So he or she is a physician or teacher that doesn't bother going to professional meetings to acquire new techniques or further old ones. It's a tennis player that develops a solid forehand and figures he can get by with a less than stellar backhand because his forehand's so good. So these are people that, you know, they don't hyper obsess about the minutia involved in their training and dot their I's and cross their T's in all areas to become a well-rounded phenom of incredible skill set. They're more dicey and up and down and all over the place. So that person too is gonna have a very difficult time. So the hacker in relationships looks to marriage not as a learning and personal growth opportunity, but more as a comfortable refuge. So it's something that's just a comfortable thing for them. It's not, you know. So in closing, like we talked about, these are just some of the characteristics of some personality types that will have a very difficult time following the master's journey. Okay, so if you fall into one of those, don't fret, don't freak out, be honest with yourself, and set forth a trajectory of personal growth through other means, meditation, yoga, spiritual practices, whatever, you know, there's lots of ways that you can cultivate the practice, the patience, the perseverance, and the persistence. The technique itself may be one that you decide, okay, art's gonna be where I put that in place, but you can't let yourself off the hook, and if you're an online student, again, you're gonna have to have more coddling. Maybe you're gonna have to do one of the mentoring programs with me or with Eric to keep you on track for a while until you get comfortable enough with your own discipline and your own trajectory that you don't need us holding your hand as much. But we're there and we do have that option for you. So if you do want and you find yourself in that situation, we can be that for you until you can be that for yourself. And that's the goal of any good teacher, really, I imagine. Okay, so that's pretty much going to wrap that up. And we're going to go into the five master keys next, which are some keys to the process of learning mastery. And then we'll finish with tools. But we're going to go through each one of those five next and talk a little bit about what George Leonard thought about each one of them and how they kind of, again, dovetail. And mostly I'm talking right now because we're talking to artists, and that's my plight, and that's my, you know, where I've been putting my energy in education for the last 25, 30 years. So I'm going to be, again, dovetailing this back around, but you could use this information, hopefully, for almost anything in your life that you're looking to become better at, whether it's relationships, whether it's some job you're working on or some sport. This information should be very, very helpful in any of those areas. So we will talk about the five master keys next.